Assistant Coordinator of the Europe Direct Information Centre at Blanchardstown Library, part of the Fingal Network of Libraries. Welcome to the fourth day in our series of interviews about the European Green Deal. Today I'll be speaking to Dublin MEP Ciarán Cuff. Ciarán Cuff is a member of the European Parliament for Dublin with the Green Party. He sits on the Energy and Transport Committees of the Parliament and serves as President of Eufores, a European NGO that promotes the deployment of renewable energy sources and energy efficiency. He is an architect and planner and graduated in 2019 with a Master's in Cities from the London School of Economics. He has served as Dublin City Councillor, TD for Dunleary and Minister for State with responsibility for sustainable transport and climate change. He lives with his family in Stonybatter in Dublin's north inner city. In today's interview, I'll be speaking to Ciarán Cuff about two subjects. Firstly, the European climate law, and secondly, we will move on to the biodiversity strategy. Hello, Ciarán, and thank you for agreeing to speak to me today.
A pleasure being with you. It's always good to take what we're doing in Brussels in Europe and communicate it to a wider audience.
That's Bren, that's exactly what we're all about at the Europe Direct Centre in Blanchardstown. And you're going to speak to us about two topics today, the European climate law and the biodiversity strategy. So we'll get started with the first of those. So could you maybe just tell us briefly what the European climate law is?
Absolutely. And climate has never been far from the headlines over the last, certainly the last period of time in Ireland, but also in Europe as well. In essence, the European climate law is about setting a limit to the amount of greenhouse gas emissions in Europe, deciding where the reductions in climate change emissions will come from, and giving a mandate to the 27 member states to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions in a fair and just way. I think very often our eyes glaze over when we start talking about the numbers and the percentages on climate change. And probably what communicates its best is the news topics over the last year, the kind of wildfires that were seen in the Western United States, in the Amazon, in Siberia, in Australia. We know that this is not normal, the level of change that is happening to the Earth's climate. And we know we need to do something about it. So that's why at the European level, we're trying to push and encourage and legislate for each country to reduce their emissions.
Excellent. And so am I right in saying that this law will be kind of reassessed every 5 years or so? And how does that work exactly?
Well, I think the best laws are revisited after a period of time to see if they're working correctly. And we have a roadmap or a target for 2050. We want to get to pretty much zero emissions or net zero. There may be emissions, there may be sinks. So overall, it balances out. We know where we want to be in 2050. Mm-hmm. We also want to set a clear roadmap for the intervening years. So by 2030, we want to have very significant reductions. But it's no use establishing a target for 10 years away and then realizing after 5 or 6 years that we're actually going in the wrong direction. So the climate law will argue that every 5 years we do a stock take and see how we're doing. Mm-hmm. And if we're not on the right glide path or the right trajectory, doing something about it. So every 5 years is when we want to do a reevaluation and increase the efforts if needed, or take the pressure off the gas if things are going okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly a very, very ambitious project, probably the biggest project the European Union has ever undertaken. And we've spoken about that with some of the other speakers. And how do we know? I mean, obviously, at the end, we know how this has been successful. But as we move through the target dates, how do we know that this law is successful?
Well, I think what we'll look at is the emissions in every country in every year. And that's happening already. And there is a hugely complicated exercise in Ireland undertaken by the Environmental Protection Agency, where they look at where greenhouse gas emissions are coming from. Obviously, a big contributor would be transport, mm-hmm. another would be energy, another would be agriculture. And they literally take every single factor into account. What kind of diesel is being used? Is it being used in cars mm-hmm. or ships? Is it another kind of hydrocarbon being used in aircraft? How many aircraft departures are there? How much concrete is being manufactured? And they essentially end up with a huge spreadsheet. And at the end of the year, and it takes a while, it takes at least another 12 months to get the figures for the mm-hmm. year that we've just finished, they come up with the figure. And we can see that in Ireland, generally speaking, over the last 30 years, our emissions have been increasing by about 20%, or sorry, by about 10% since 1990. Whereas actually in Europe, the trend has been in the other direction. The emissions have come down by about 20%. But it does vary from year to year. In the years running up to the Celtic Tiger 10 years ago, there was massive increases year on year. Mm. Then there was a dip, and recently they've been coming up again. So the trends are a little bit different looking backwards, but looking forwards at both an Irish level with the climate bill that was published last week and at a European level with the European climate law, we're all saying we need to be making reductions. We're having rows as to whether it's 40%, 50%, 60%, 70%. Generally, when you talk to scientists, they say we need higher reductions. Mm-hmm. They say, and I mean, I've had these conversations, and the closer you get to the kind of people working at, I suppose, ironically, you could call it the coal face. Often it's at the ice face in the Arctic, where they're drilling for ice cores and looking back on what's been happening over a million years. And these scientists tell us, look, we really need to dramatically reduce our emissions as fast as possible, because we're seeing evidence, you know, the lowest amount of sea ice in the Arctic, the second lowest that we've ever seen this year, and most of the years over the last 20 years have broken records. So we need to do a lot, and we need to do it now. So in the European climate law, the European Parliament said we should try and reduce emissions by 60% over the next 10 years.
Yeah, so as I said, a really lofty target, and I mean, what I get from what you're saying there is, I mean, there's some serious analysis going into measuring, you know, every few years how the law is actually working. So could we move on to maybe how would the European climate law affect, for example, me personally, or the kind of generation coming after me? How will this affect my life?
That's a really good question. The best way I can communicate that is by saying every single area of activity, of economic activity, mm-hmm. has to change significantly. Construction, agriculture, energy production, travel. We have to look at different ways of doing things that are either low or zero carbon. So for me, I mean, or maybe for yourself, I think about how do I move around? We have a car, but I do my best to reduce my car journeys. And very often I either walk or use the bike for traveling around town. So that's where we change things in transport. You might say, well, how are you going to get to Brussels? And yeah, I do fly, but I've tried to reduce the amount of times I fly by going over for 2 weeks or 3 weeks at a time. And about one journey in four, instead of flying, I take the boat, literally. From Dublin to Holyhead, I take a train down to London, and then I walk a few minutes down from Euston to St Pancras, and I take a Eurostar that brings me over to Brussels in 2 hours. That whole journey takes about a day, about 12 hours. Yes, it's a bit of a pain to do it, but the carbon footprint is probably one-tenth that of flying. Mm-hmm. And while I'm not saying that we all have to do that, or we have to do that every time we consider taking a flight, I'm trying to do it one trip in four. Mm-hmm. So that probably reduced my carbon footprint by 20 or 25%. If we could do that in the next few years and do a little bit more in 10 years' time, it's good for the planet. So that's transport. Then briefly to talk about those other sectors, I guess in construction, I worked hard to get new building regulations so that a new home has an A energy rating, and that is the law. Europe has helped bring that about, but any new home in Ireland has to have an A2 energy rating, which essentially brings your fuel, your annual fuel bills down to several hundred euro instead of several thousand euro. So that's one thing we can do in construction. And I've just written a report for the European Parliament on how we get the existing buildings to near zero by the year 2050. And to do that, we need something called the renovation wave. We need to refurbish every building, put in the insulation, kick out the old gas boiler, move towards heat pumps, make sure there's no drafts in the house. All of this stuff is new to a lot of people, but it can be done. It's not cheap. It requires money. But there's never been a better time to look for money. Mm-hmm. You know, the World Bank, the European banks, the European Investment Bank, they want to put money into this. So money is cheap at the moment. And I think we'll see a big move towards green financing in the years ahead. Mm-hmm. So that's the construction sector. And then very briefly to talk about energy and agriculture. Well, in energy, we're already getting 40% of our electricity from renewables in Ireland. We want to get that up to 70% by 2030. How do we do that? More wind farms, not just on land, but out at sea. We need to build these massive wind turbines, and we need to make sure that we join different countries' energy systems together. We already have some power lines between here and the UK. We're about to build a massive power line to France, and we'll probably need to loop more power lines across the North Sea, connecting Norway, Sweden, Denmark. So that when the wind blows in Ireland, we can export the surplus energy. And when it's a calm day in Ireland, we'll suck in electricity from other countries. A massive project. We can't do that overnight, but we need to do it. And I think the last sector that I didn't talk about was agriculture. People say, look, are we going to get rid of cattle? No, we're not. You know, I'll still be drinking milk in 10 years' time, but maybe more people will be drinking a milk that comes from oats or other products. Maybe eating meat will be not a daily thing, but maybe something you do once or twice a week. That's very controversial, but look, I mean, at a personal level, I live with a family of vegetarians. Yes, I eat meat, but, you know, I look forward to it. Maybe it's I buy a bit of red meat on a Friday or Saturday, but it's certainly not a daily treat, and I think we need to do that nationally. And for farming, I think there will be opportunities in farming, in horticulture, in growing vegetables and fruit. There'll be opportunities in forestry, in agro-tourism. So we do need to change what we're doing in agriculture. There'll still be a beef industry and a dairy industry in 10 years' time, but we want to give people other options. And at the moment, through the Common Agricultural Policy, we provide a massive subsidy to meat and to dairy, and maybe we need to rethink that and spread the money into other sectors so that we're not just focused on one sector.
Yeah, I mean, so it's clear from what you're saying that there's kind of going to be very huge changes in our lives coming in the next few years. But as Patrick O'Riordan said in his interview about the just transition and financing the deal, that these changes should be seen really as an opportunity to make some very positive changes in how we live our lives in a more sustainable way. So before we move on to speaking about the biodiversity strategy, I just want to ask you one last thing to do with the climate law. I mean, Ireland is one of the countries, and you kind of alluded to that earlier, that has struggled with emissions. And what are the ramifications in the climate law for states that fail to keep to the targets laid out in the climate law?
Well, I think the European Union prefers to work with carrots rather than sticks. Mm-hmm. So I guess the if we fail to comply, there will be encouragement. But if we don't, ultimately, it could go to the European Court of Justice, and a court judgment against Ireland could result in very high daily fines. And we already face the prospect of them. So we're much better off taking action early, rather than waiting till the last minute. And, you know, I think we've always had this difficulty in Ireland that even though we joined the EU in 1973 or the predecessor to the EU, we tend to think of it as being a little bit like a school teacher, And we kind of put off doing our homework until the 11th of hour. 11th hour, and if we don't do it, we kind of say the dog ate it or something like that. And I think we need to really, you know, mature a bit and think slightly differently about Europe, and think of Europe as being a partner to what we do in Ireland, rather than putting off the difficult things until the 11th hour. And I think that will help us in the long run. And certainly when it comes to the just transition or taking action on climate, I think we're much better off taking early action. And I think that will benefit us. And I remember as a kid flying into Copenhagen back in 1983. And as we came into land, I could see wind turbines on the horizon. It took us at least 20, if not 30 years to try and emulate what Denmark was doing. And now they have a thriving business in the green economy. They export wind turbines all around the world. Think if we had made different choices 30 years ago, how we could be today. But I think the same still applies. We still have opportunities in agriculture, in energy today. And if we embrace them early, we'll benefit much more in the years ahead.
Absolutely, yeah. Okay, so and I suppose moving on, I mean, you just mentioned agriculture, and the next part of our discussion now, I suppose, would be related to that in some ways, and it's the biodiversity strategy. So could you tell us a little bit about the biodiversity strategy? What's it all about?
Well, I guess as a member of the Greens, I often talk about climate change, and sometimes people say, look, all you do is talk about climate change. What about the other issues that impact on our lives? And actually, if you talk to ecologists or if you talk to people, to farmers who are walking the land every day, they will say, look, it's not just about climate change. We also have to conserve the land and we have to take into account biodiversity. Biodiversity is a big word. Mm. What do we mean by that? In the Irish context, it can be hedgerows. It can be the different species that we have on the land, the different trees, the different grasses, this web of nature that we have been used to taking care of for thousands of years. And we can't simply just concentrate on reducing greenhouse gas emissions. We have to conserve what we have to make sure that the wildlife we have in Ireland continues to thrive, to make sure that in the sea that we don't simply fish every single species out of existence. Mm-hmm. And so we have to conserve our biodiversity. So we have a biodiversity and a farm to fork strategy. They all heavily link in to what we call CAP and CAP reform. CAP is the Common Agricultural Policy or Plan, and we have to ensure that the CAP reform makes sure that we conserve what we already have. So historically, we might have seen farmers taking out hedgerows to create larger fields. Mm-hmm. We might have seen larger and larger trawlers. You may remember the controversy about the Atlantic mm-hmm. Dawn, this massive 200-300 foot long trawler that was built 20 years ago. And while some people said, this is brilliant, this is the future, bigger trawlers, bigger farms, others were saying, like the Greens were saying, wait, hold on here a second. How many people will be employed? How many species will be threatened by going bigger, faster, larger? And that's where biodiversity comes into it. And there are now biodiversity targets that say we want to ensure we protect species. So we do exercises every year to see how fish stocks are doing. And we get advice and quotas and limits on making sure we don't fish a species out of extinction. In very simple terms, mackerel is usually doing quite well. So eat mackerel. But cod is not doing well, so go easy on that. But it gets more complicated than that, because we might have one species that is doing well in the Irish Sea, another species that is not doing so well, or maybe in the North Atlantic, there's other quotas for different species in different areas. And the same on land. We want to try and plant more forestry, but not just fast-growing pine trees. We want to make sure that we have a variety of tree cover. Deciduous trees, they take a bit longer to grow. Maybe they're not as profitable in the short term as lodgepole pine or Norway spruce. But we want to use the European instruments like the biodiversity strategy to diversify the kind of species we have on land and sea, and make sure we just don't go from monoculture of the entire country growing one type of pine tree, or every farm just growing barley or just growing wheat. And that means we change the CAP policy and we use the biodiversity strategy to make this happen.
Okay, that's very interesting. One thing, when I've been reading about the biodiversity strategy, a term that kept coming up was this idea of a carbon sink. And could you perhaps explain to us exactly what a carbon sink is and what the EU is doing to create more of these on a Europe-wide level and on an Irish level?
Yeah, carbon sink sounds a bit daunting, but I think we all remember when we were in school learning about the water cycle, that the rivers flow to the sea, the water evaporates and comes back through clouds that rain on the land. And that's the water cycle. But there's also a carbon cycle, because cattle eat grass and they produce methane. Over time, that methane becomes carbon dioxide. But in very simple terms, grass or trees, they sequester carbon. They suck up that carbon dioxide that is emitted by cattle or by cars. And what we want to try and do is make sure we have more carbon sinks, more grass, more forestry that will absorb carbon. And that means that we will try and encourage more planting to act as a carbon sink. And also we're trying to encourage that more cutaway bogs are re-wetted, because in doing so, that stops more carbon being emitted. These are quite significant changes in how we manage our land use. And so the discussion is not just about farming, it's about land use and the different uses that we have on different types of farm. And there's different policy instruments that will help us with our carbon sinks and with biodiversity. One issue we're trying to do is to leave 10% space for nature on our farms. That could be a hedgerow, leaving 5 meters of land on each side of a hedgerow that we don't plough and don't plant. Or it could mean leaving ponds on land. And by 2030, trying to ensure that 30% of land and seas in the European Union are protected. So we talk about 30-30. 30% of land's protected by 2030. So it's a bit of a change in how we manage lands, and it's a bit of a change of mindset as well. And bodies like Chagas or the Department of Agriculture, I know from working within the Department of Agriculture as a junior minister 10 years ago, they were quite focused on maximising output, quite focused on using more fertiliser. And now, in a sense, we're turning away from that and saying, how can we use less fertiliser? How can we have an output that is not just about quantity, that is more about quality? This is a big change. And there's fellas, I guess, the same age as me in their late 50s, who've spent their entire life trying to maximise what we do with the land. Mm-hmm. And now the question or the problem becomes more complex. It's about not just getting the output, it's having a better output and leaving space for nature. So it does mean thinking again. And I think Chagas are struggling with this. They have to change what they do, because traditionally they taught farmers how to get more and more from their land. And the idea of getting less output with more space for nature, it's a bit counterintuitive, but this is the direction we have to go. And the European Union land uses that are sustainable in the years ahead.
And it's very interesting what you said there, because this is something that came up when speaking to Patrick O'Riordan, that we need a new way of measuring success in terms of economics, but also, as you're saying, in terms of agriculture as well. So just to kind of move on before I give you a question from the public, I just want to ask you, can you give some examples of projects either in Ireland or across Europe that are linked to the biodiversity strategy? I know Jonathan Claridge already spoke to us about a corncrake project in Ireland. Is there anything else you could tell us about?
Of actual projects, We have, you've spoken about the corncrake and protecting the corncrake, which is very much an endangered species, along with other types of bird life. But an example I often talk about is the Burren Bio Project, which has been on the go for about 20 years in County Clare, in the lands around the Burren, where you've a special landscape of the karst stone, the limestone, which drains very quickly. And traditionally, cattle were brought up onto the uplands in the winter and down into the lowlands during the summer, which is unusual in the European context. But you produce a really delicious type of meat from the cattle that grow on those lands. And there's been assistance given from Europe to help with that project and encourage it. And I think often we look at regional produce, regional products and regional practices, and Europe is realizing that we need to encourage this, whether it's local food of the blah type of bread down in Waterford or the Burren beef on the west coast of Ireland. I think we'll see more of that in the years to come. And I think cap reform, if it's done right, will encourage small producers and local traditional practices and work with them to preserve them and encourage them in the years ahead.
Yeah, that's very interesting. You speak about the Burren, because I mean it's such a unique place and with a unique biodiversity, isn't it? It's like nowhere else in Ireland, really.
It really is. And anybody who's kind of stood on a hill in East Clare and looked out at the Burren will know that this is a unique landscape that is. I mean, we've designated it as a national park, but it is of international importance and needs to be further protected in the years to come.
Absolutely. And to finish up, I'm just going to go with a question that was sent in to us by a member of the public from John. And John, I'll read this out to you because there's a little bit of detail to it. He said, as we respond to COVID, people are perhaps surprised that the Irish state can mandate how we live our lives in good detail for the public good. He then goes on to say, it seems no bad thing, and it makes me wonder why we've been too shy in mandating new climate-related rules for households and business. And he goes on to give an example. Assuming a reasonable degree of notice of a change to business, can we not mandate that all packaging be 100% recyclable, for example? And I'm just wondering if we just need to be a little less shy these days and trust the general public desire to avoid harming nature so much. So what would you have to say to John there?
I think that's a really good question. And while there has been an explosion of interest in green issues in the last few years, it's only a year and a half ago that there was a handful of green councillors and two green TDs out of a Dáil with 160-odd people. So while many people kind of say, oh, I'm green and I like the environment, politically, they're not voting for the kind of measures that you talk about. To take that very simple issue of a plastic bag that is compostable or biodegradable, that has to come through a European Union directive. And what I've seen over the last year in Europe is the lobby groups that are hard at work. So when it comes to any change in Europe, there will be dozens of lobbyists in the corridors of the European Parliament really pushing those MEPs not to go so fast on measures that maybe the Greens like, but you'll see the European People's Party, which is tied into Fine Gael, Fianna Fáil, part of the Renew group in Europe. They are often quite cautious on moving as quickly as I would like, or as I think science dictates on these kind of issues. So I find this agonizingly slow. It's really challenging. Even, you know, everybody says, oh, why can't you bring back a bottle that is returnable for a deposit? Which I remember as a kid, bringing back the Sidona bottles and getting 5 pence in the old money for them. But to do that, it requires legislation, not actually at European level, but at the national level. But we already have a company called Repack that we're given a contract to encourage recycling. So we would have to rethink that contract to make sure you get money when you bring back something. I think now there is a groundswell of support for this. It may take a year or two to happen, but I think what was unthinkable 2 or 3 years ago is going to happen soon. And I think sadly, with these increasingly dramatic weather events in California or elsewhere, we're realizing that we do need to make changes in Ireland. And hopefully it'll happen at a rate that is compatible with keeping the global temperatures to under 1.5 degrees rise. But, you know, we don't know. We're in uncharted territory. The scientists are saying, go quickly, go fast. The politicians are saying, well, I don't know, we have to listen to everybody. And the Greens are certainly stuck in the middle on that, saying we have to move faster, but we do have to work within a system where change can be far too slow.
Well, listen, on that note, I'd like to thank you for speaking to me today. I've certainly learned a huge amount about the European climate law and biodiversity, and I hope the people watching the videos at home and in schools will have got a lot out of that. So thank you very, very much, Ciarán.
Thanks, a real pleasure to talk to you today. And great to talk on Zoom. I mean, I talked about teleworking when I was first elected. I wanted to use teleworking more so that I didn't have to be on a plane twice a week. And it's actually happened. I mean, it's been an awful time for so many people and their families. But one of the upsides is that I don't have to be in Brussels all the time. And my carbon footprint has reduced quite significantly over the last 9 months.
Absolutely. And as I said to you before we started, when we last spoke, it was on Zoom and we didn't know back then, you know, what was coming down the line, that it was something we'd be using a lot more often. So
I remember sellotaping my camera phone to a computer screen. It's become a little bit more sophisticated.
Yeah, we're all experts now.
And thank you for encouraging me to do that.
So thank you, Ciarán.
We'll talk again soon. Thank
Bye-bye.
You.
Bye-bye. Many thanks to Ciarán for his engaging and thorough explanation of the European climate law and the biodiversity strategy. It's clear from hearing Ciarán speak that we have a very unique and delicate biodiversity situation here in Ireland, especially in areas such as the Burren. And I think we all look forward to seeing some of the projects he mentioned come to fruition. In our final interview tomorrow, I'll be speaking to Aoife Sheridan from Fingal County Council. Aoife will be speaking about the impact of the European Green Deal on a local level in Fingal and on a national level in Ireland as a whole. You can join us at 11 a.m. on our YouTube and Facebook pages. We look forward to seeing you then. Thank you.